Welcome to Talking Sustainability at the Sustainability Education Research Institute. So we're excited today to host Dr. Stefan Bengtsson. There's Stefan. And we're going to hear today about power and hegemony in critical environmental education policy research. So I, for one, am really excited. We'll begin the day with a short round of introductions. If everyone could just introduce themselves briefly, their name and where they're coming from today. And then we'll have Stefan's presentation, which is on MindMeister. So we'll do here, we'll follow the mapping on the screen. And following the presentation, we'll have a more interactive session, questions for Stefan and discussion of the topic. Adam, would you like to begin?
Hi, Stefan. I'm Adam Young, an MS student.
I cannot see you though.
Sorry, I'm off on the side where I have access to laptop.
We have some more chairs over
on the side.
Thank you, from the digital intern that I'm also studying. And I will not be suited with.
He just attended his PhD a few weeks ago.
Oh, congratulations, congratulations.
Thanks, and I need that within my conference.
Sorry, there is a little bit of different input from different areas. Sorry.
Lyle.
Sure. Thanks, Adam. Nice seeing Marcia there. Lyle Benko, co-coordinator of RC Saskatchewan. We're very proud to be working closely with SERI in this event to support it, and actually was part of its inauguration just a few years ago. I'm very excited to have one of our very good colleagues and friends all the way from down under, Helen Angelikas, from Great Western Sydney RCE in Australia. So, Helen?
Hi, Helen here. And I'd like to say we turn the world around and we're not actually down under. We're on top now. I'm from RCE, Greater Western Sydney, and the University of Western Sydney. And I'm very interested about this because we do sustainability. Our office is the Office of Sustainability. So this is very interesting to me. Thank you.
Thanks. So we'll continue here back to SERI.
Lyle, maybe if you don't mind muting again, Stefan was having trouble hearing the folks here in the background there. If you don't mind muting. Yes, thank you.
Are you asking for me or for Helen to repeat it?
No, if you can mute your sound.
Remember what you did before?
Yeah, there you go.
Thanks.
Thank you.
My name is Jaylene, and I'm an MS student and working with SERI
and
Stefan here.
And my name is Tanner Dealer, and I'm a postdoc here at the Sustainability Education Policy Network.
My name is Kathleen Higgins, and I'm a PhD student here at SERI and Stefan.
I'm glad they can hear. Can you see me from?
No, not see. I can hear a bit.
that's a shame because I'm the oldest person. I'm the average age of about 10 years by walking in. My interest started with education for sustainable development, but I've been working in science education related to Indigenous cross-cultural education, and that's my background.
Great. Thanks, everyone.
Can we also say maybe that Jada Kuchik is online? Maybe won't required.
Hello, thank you. Yes, my name is Jada Kuchik, and I'm a second year doctoral student with the Stefan project.
Thanks, Jada.
Thank you.
Okay, so we'll have our presentation now. Stefan, I think we're ready to go.
Perfect. Everyone hears me? Can I have a thumbs up if you can hear me? Perfect. I would like to thank you, first of all, giving me the opportunity to speak a little bit here. And about myself, I've finished my PhD last year and have been working as a lecturer here at the Department of Education at Uppsala University. I'm going to finish that position at the end of this week. Tomorrow is going to be my last day, and then I'm going to start as the national coordinator for the ESD gap implementation in Sweden at the Swedish center here in Uppsala, which is a national research implementation center on ESD. So I'm going to look forward to be working that. The talk I'm going to give today, and as I see, it's a very small group, so you can ask questions and jump in, and so we maybe don't need to have it too structured. So maybe I try to bake in some short gaps where we can have a little bit of a chat. It's not going to be so much of a monologue, but the talk I'm going to give today is a little bit based on my own research. It's not a little bit based, it is my actual research, but so it's based on a paper which is going to come out next year in the Journal of Environmental Education. But it ties very much into my other research as well, which is very much looking on conceiving the political positioning of ESD in different national contexts. And so I'm trying to look a little bit at how within the field of environmental education research critique against ESD has been put forward. And well, what this presentation is going to do is to synthesize some of the aspects and how certain problems can emerge in certain of the critiques that are put forward. Okay, let's start. So the topic of this talk is regarding the conceptions of power and hegemony in critical environmental education. And I'm going to cover five areas, which are going to be the overall framing of critique as it is put forward in environmental education. Second, I'm going to specify then a critique of ESD drawing on the conception of globalization. The third is then critiques of ESD arguing against the maintenance of the status quo and how ESD is related to a status quo. Then I'm going to construct, based on the logics in this critique, a problem or a paradox, which is then to combine, I see it to result out of combinations of conceptions of structural power, which very much then limit the notions of agency, I think. And I'm going to go a little bit also like sidelines into what that means for policy, actually. And then in the last part, I'm going to go into a reconfiguration of critique or critical approaches to ESD and environmental education. Yes. I hope you can see my slide here now. Yes. So the overall framing of the critiques and there are certain logics, as I said, that it can find again. And ESD is very much critiqued based on its overall perceived capacity to contribute to social change and to provide a radical alternative imaginary. And what often is questioned then in research is, for example, the genuine commitment to challenge the status quo. And based then on the affiliation with ESD, with a perceived status quo, then the inability of ESD is critiqued to challenge existing structural power and relations. I'm going to specify a little bit more now how this critique can be developed into smaller logics then. And here, the critique is often drawing on conceptions of globalization. And here we see then globalization, for example, is in Yikling, and Yikling involves globalization as a force that has effects on context. And then globalization is also seen as working through international organizations. And then in a Marxist Althusserian way, globalization is also perceived as working through what we might call state apparatuses. And then that globalization and power is working and also as through policy, where as part of that conception globalization, the force is seen to work from different levels and different scales down from the international to the national, and then through policy and these transitions to the local level. And ESD is then something as perceived as it has not been growing up from bottom up, but is seen as an externally imposed alien concept that stands in contrast to contextually embedded grassroots expressions. So what we can also see in these two separations is that on the one hand side we have ESD, which is something new, something alien, which is developed at the global level, and then we have in these framings also environmental education, which is very much perceived as something that has grown up locally and has taken up its form from the local to the national to the international level. And we see then here ESD as an part of an external imposition of meaning, and so from the external on the local, and that imposition is then trying to establish a form of conformity through policymaking as an authoritative text which tries to regulate practices. And thereby, it's also a corruption of meaning, as meaning is often perceived in relationship to local meaning making, where that external imposition dissolves the possibility of making specific practical meanings as they emerge in context. And then ESD is seen as a form of the power of universal discourse, which reduces in that way meaning to a minimum, where, for example, a lot of the critique has highlighted the emptiness of the concept of ESD, that it doesn't have any particular meaning, everything can be attached to it, and in that way also dissolves the meaning that becomes possible in different contexts. What I ask myself then, if I have a closer look at the critique, if universal discourse is powerful, if there is something as a universal discourse and it has power, and we conceive then here power as force as its effect on context and is able to impose meaning, what theoretical possibilities for resistance exist? So it has very much to do with the conception of power and of effect of one action upon another. And in relation to that conception of globalization, there's also a critique of ESD, as I said earlier, arguing against its possibility to challenge the status quo. And the critique is also putting forward that ESD is not much incapable of changing, but the whole concept is about not to challenge the status quo. As I said already, then the critique is seeing it as to reconstitute status quo rather than to challenge it. And policy, that has also very much to do with the conception of policy and quite a lot of Swedish, for example, in the Swedish context of critical curriculum studies, there has been conception of policy, educational policy, for example, as a form of consensus, where those policies determining education can be seen as the common denominator, which are the results of a political struggle and have found its way into the consensus, where we can see then policy as a result of a struggle where it is to some extent taken off the edges of the political struggles. So to some extent then policy is also seen as that which has least conflictual potential. And the status quo is then seen also as to provide the context as a basis for action. And policy is then seen as an expression of that status quo. And I see here a paradox, which is then very much emerges out of the theoretical conceptions that which come from Marxist through post-Marxist to, for example, Foucault's conception of power. As these scholars partially draw on that conception, that in that conception of power, the language of the individual is determined by discourse. But then at the same time as what is possible to be said and also done is determined, there's an appeal to the individual as being able to emancipate itself. So we have a paradox. On the one hand side, the individual is determined very much by discourse, and the other side, there's also the possibility of resistance, of emancipation from discourse, but where becomes really problematic to conceive how that becomes possible. So then, if context determines language and discursive practice, as for example in that Foucauldian notion of the enunciative function of the subject, how can it become possible that the subject can emancipate itself from it? So, for example, in order to explain what I mean there, What Foucault and quite many other post-structuralists can be seen to be done, they're making up with that idea of the Enlightenment subject as that can create itself and what it is in the world by its own willingness and its own will to change the world. And what Foucault and others do is then to show that it's all what the subject can do. The preconditions for action, for meaning making, are historical. And Foucault goes so far in the ecology of knowledge to reduce the role of the subject to enunciating discourse. So the subject is just re-articulating discourse. But if then, for example, meaning is already pre-given and the subject is already, only articulating meaning that can become possible, how can it change meaning? And that is one of the paradoxes and challenges that I find in these conceptions of critique that build their critique on these notions of power. And I think before I continue rambling on, maybe if you have some questions or remarks so far.
Remarks from the audience here?
Well, maybe I just lost the thread a little bit with in terms of talking about EST. EST is an emancipation of the status quo and critiques around that, and then the focus on the individual and how the individual is constructed through discourse and yet the possibilities for resistance are within that. So, like, I missed the shift from EST to the individual. Can you articulate that?
Maybe if I go a little bit back. To some extent, then, what ESD, for example, is an educational policy for ESD is seen as determined by overall historical structural formations. For example, then the critique that we are living in an age of neoliberalism. Where that form of historical context determines what ESD becomes. So it is an expression of those historical, political, economical structures. But the point then is, okay, if ESD is that, as it is determined by these historical constructions, and these historical formations then determine meaning, then in that same line of critiquing, you can ask us which possibilities are there for the subject to change those conditions. Because in the end, what then will be is that we could ask us, okay, if we have this position between EE and ESD, how can EE be different? In that sense, it can only be different as is this part of a past, which is a reminder, or it's totally irrational. But then, as power has also this effect over time to show the conditions that are determining how it is, then the subject in that sense is not possible to alter it. And I'm going to a little bit back later into how I problematize also these conceptions of structural power. Actually, they draw on history, that they have a particular notion of time and history also that. Because if for example, if we take that back to because these conceptions of history, they come very much from also from a Marxist notion of historical development in stages. And what the Marxist theory has been struggling with is that, okay, we have a universal historical development, and how can we fit into this universal development context that don't really adhere to the principles of that historical stage that we're in. For example, then Trotsky has been working with that conception of the weakest link, where he's actually just trying to explain how Russia, during the Tsarist, after the Bolshevik Revolution, fits into that historical stage, but where Russia doesn't really fit into that capitalist depiction, because Russia is not industrialized. So what they then try to do is to take the difference, the variation, and to form it in under a universal principle. But at that same time, to come back to what you're arguing, Marshall, or what you're inquiring, is we could see that difference as also as a part of a political struggle, which is political struggle. A struggle in that sense is also an individual subjective struggle of particular groups. If you do that, then if you conceive of that historical stage as an universal, you're subduing the potential of the political struggle also already to something predetermined. So for example, I or my social group are able to achieve something, it's not because that we were able to do it. It was a historical stage already determining it. So, and this problem of how agency emerges, then I think it's already built into certain forms of critique, and then it's inherited into certain, we might call, for example, post-structuralist critiques or so.
Thanks, Stefan. You can, I guess you can continue on.
Okay. Because I think it brings me, if I may just finish that thought, what is also to do with policy. We had these critical curriculum studies in Sweden in the late 70s and the 80s, which historizes the educational policy. And what the point of departure is, and we find that paradox there as well, is that educational policy is just an expression of the power relations at a given point in time. So it's the policy, it cannot actually change anything as it is determined by the political, the historical, socioeconomic possibilities. And what they make really clear is, even though most innovative teachers or whatever, they cannot anything do about, for example, social injustices, as these are maintained through the state, through the historical context. So that's the point of departure, and which I think, to some extent, then also emerges again, what actually can we do about it if we base our critique of policy on these lines of reasoning? Maybe I'm going to repeat myself a little bit here, and then look a little bit of the problem that emerges then, is then that there's, in these critiques, there's a reliance on notions of power as a causal force that has determinate results. And what I mean by that is that power is, to some extent, there's a universal relationship between the before and the after. So power is conceived, if someone has power now, we already know which determinate effect is going to have in the after. Well, I think then that notion of power erases the possibility of the subject to alter these courses, because the power is already a priori determining the outcome in that sense, so that the subject cannot emerge once it is power, it's a structural power that determines what can come out afterwards. In that sense, the only possibility, I think, of change which emerges then is not a change, it's a result of the subject altering things, but it's a change that is external to the structure itself, because the structure, in this sense, is it's in a determinate state, so it's reproducing itself. So change can only be externally initiated. So I like to use that example of the record player, because that's some of the problems that I think also Foucault struggles with, even in his later work on conceptions of power, is how like biopower, governmentality, how can we get out of that? And I would like sometimes to use the example of the record player. So we are in this track and following. We cannot get out of the track. And what I mean by an external force is that if you want to change the possibilities of being and giving meaning to the world, the only possibility of change in that mode of reasoning would be that someone would be hitting the record player hard from the outside so that the needle skips. So the needle and the mode of doing things and changing things cannot be changed from the inside, not from the where the needle is moving and how we are moving it, but it just can be an external force that changes things. And as I said already, there's an additional problematic, and which is very much closely related to that, is that I think lots of these critiques draw upon Marx's notion of history. There are, for example, these conceptions of the stage, age, or current global prevalence of neoliberalist capitalist production. And what is often either implicitly explicitly expressed in this, that is also entailing these conceptions of history and historic development, there is this notion in, for example, in Marx's theory that the historic development is predetermined. As, for example, we see in Marx's thought that we already know where history is heading, and that there's a move from capitalism to socialism and then to communism. And which comes then back also to that notion or the metaphor of the record player. History cannot be, in this understanding, cannot be changed by subjects, but is the result of an unfolding of an already pre-existing condition. So that fall, the rise and fall of capitalism has already all the time been there. So it's just an unfolding of a historical process which we can watch. And if we know how the early Marxists were, they knew that capitalism is going to fall. And they're just waiting for the fall of capitalism. And then later people saw, it's still there. What can we do about it? But what I'm addressing here is not so much what change is going to happen, but the relationship between how history is drawn upon in order to conceive of the possibilities of change. And if we apply then that logic also to the critique, then if we say that we are in a stage of neoliberal capitalism, any deviance from that is often also associated with that historical notion that we will become eventually subjugated to capitalism as something that is already inscribed in its age, and we cannot really alter it. And then, for me, then there are two options. If we really should follow these historical notions of change and also possibility of critique, should we, like Marx, wait and see what's happened, or maybe have another conception of change? For me, then there are, if we apply these logics by which we conceive the possibilities of change, like the classical critique of the structural power, then there's this option of accelerationism, which is quite big now in speculative realism. So as we cannot change historical development, the only thing option is left to us is then that we accelerate. So if we know that we cannot change our transition to a neoliberalist capitalist system, we cannot change that. We just can accelerate the transition. And then for us, maybe as those critical to it, we can, our critique would be in that way that we become hyper neoliberal capitalist environmental educators. But then for me, then the chance is we were making a big bet. So to some extent, then we're hoping only that that which comes after is a better option. Some critics maybe want to go that way. I do not want to go that way. Are there any comments, remarks, or questions at the moment? Do you follow my line of reasoning so far?
Yes. Did I use your record analogy? Going back to the record, I'm old enough to remember 78s. 45s and long plays when those came in. So I'm just wanting to double check that I understand what you're saying using that analogy, that if we're trapped in a capitalist framework, it's the equivalent to the record.
And yeah.
You are not optimistic that we could change the format to a CD and then attack the problem from there. And I've just heard you say, and this is what I'm checking, that the way people are doing it now is to go from a 78 record to a 45 record to a long play record, so you don't get to the end of the record as fast, but we're going to get to the end of the record.
It's a nice analogy that you're using. First of all, that's not my point. That's not my position. I'm going to start my position after that. But I would like to utilize that metaphor as the problems emerging out of a particular form of critique. And to use your expansion on the metaphor, I think that we have different tracks on a LP record, right? So we can move to the next track, and that would probably be different stages in historical development, like track one, first song, second song, and we are in this track. And I think that one of the options for those, not me, that I'm not adhering to that form of critique is, would then be, as you said, if we have a long, like a 33, that we accelerate the pace so that we get to the, we play it as a 45er while we're on a 33 record. Just in order to make sure that we're getting faster to the next track, and hope that the next track is a better one that is very boring love song that we're listening to at the moment.
Stefan?
Yeah.
Lyle here, can you hear us?
Yeah.
Some good news and some bad news. The good news is we've really enjoyed what we've heard so far. The bad news is we're going to have to excuse ourselves, like I mentioned earlier before you started. But maybe just before we go, I think Helen has a comment and I have another comment too, just briefly, not knowing where the slides are already going, but I think Helen's already wondering from her perspective about the slides. Helen?
Yeah, I find it very interesting that and not knowing where they're going, my question is, how do you know, and it needs to be a mind reader, how do you know how people are going to interpret what you're actually saying? Different people interpret the different language differently. So I don't quite know, because we haven't seen the rest of your slides, where that's going. So that was just, in your research, how did you discover this? Do you have a way of finding or understanding people and how they interpret how you're talking?
Okay. Before you leave, then, what just to give you just a hint where I'm heading afterwards is that what I say is that what I'm trying to do is then to limit the structural power, which is not a return then that we can do whatever we want and we're totally free, but that there are limits to it. And for example, in my own research, I was looking at Vietnamese policymaking on sustainable development and education for sustainable development. And what I showed then in my policy research was that there are totally different conceptions of sustainable development in the same policy document, as they are different political groups trying to invest in what sustainable development is. And my argument also in that paper is then that, okay, but if we have these differences in the problem, in a policy document, there has never been that moment of a consensus. You understand what I mean? That the political dynamics are still there. And what I then say is that, okay, so we have these different conceptions of sustainable development or education for sustainable development. And so they do not determine what, for example, educators can do or have to do or whatever. But it requires us to do moral political choices. For example, if an educator in Sweden have this policy concept conceiving ESD as this and that, I have to do a choice which form of ESD I want to engage with in my education. So to come back to your question, as I understand it, is and of course, there are different understandings, as language never really is able to determine the meaning in that sense, as I in my own research, try to show that the same concept has different meanings.
Yeah.
I appreciate that also, Stefan. And again, we're already running a little bit late for our next commitment, but I really have enjoyed your focus on what I would call the power of words and your discussion with the limits of structural power. I'm sure most of us, Marcy would know, with their ESD policy at the U of S and us developing our policy at the U of R, through the RCE connections with the new Global Action Program with UNESCO, this understanding of words, and you've been very succinct in trying to look at that, I still always question, you know, it's not so much about the meaning of the words, it's how the people use them and how they understand them. And now the struggle then is, how is that interpreted through policy, and then how is that policy interpreted through action? So again, not knowing where you're going, but that is a struggle that I have seen being involved with sustainability for more than 20 years. And I appreciate the work that you're doing. And it's interesting to see you quoting Jickling. I've done some work with Jickling probably 10, 15 years ago, and know what the environmental model was, but now how does that translate into the sustainable model? And I would tend to say that the new UNESCO Global Action Program might make it easier for that vehicle to do as you're saying. Look at what these limits are to the structural power. But again, this is your presentation, and we just wanted to thank you again for inviting us to be here, and we wish you the best. And will the slides be available after that?
I can send you a link so you can have a look at it. Okay. If I would just make the final remarks, I think you took up a very interesting issue there, which I didn't mention very much, is that that paper ties back into that what you were at this big critique between EE versus ESD. And what I'm trying to do, and also in the context with my my work later for GAP implementation, is then to say that because that whole critique is based upon that notion that there is something as EE and there's something as ESD, and what I would like to highlight also, and with that we have to ask a critical question: what kind of EE and what kind of ESD we're going to have. And I think that for example, for our work in Sweden, it will be very important to highlight, okay, which versions of ESD we want to highlight and which maybe we want to tone down or problematize also, as they can be seen not to be challenging enough to education.
Okay, Thank you very much. No?
Thank you very much. Yes, very interesting. I look forward to seeing the rest of the slides. Thank you.
Bye.
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 Okay. You want me to move to the next, or?
Yeah, why don't you continue?
Okay, okay, good, good. So then to come to the final part, my reconfiguration of the critique. So I'm still trying to be critical in the sense, not of critical in the sense of supposing that there's something universally good or wrong, but as critique, as more as a reflexive praxis, or which maybe also allows us to clarify on political and moral positions that we want to attain. Well, what I then try to do through landing from the work of Laclau Mufis then to introduce a negative, which to some extent subverts the positivity of any structure. And to reformulate what that means is that if the structure and in the notion of Foucault and structural power determines positive identity, we have to introduce something theoretically which allows the structure not to become fully determining in that sense. Because once it's fully determining, then we're stuck in that whole problem of structural power determining and reproducing it automatically itself. And that's what I'm trying to do then in my work, is to introduce a limit that prevents the structure from fully determining a subject. And then that limit is actually which makes us become political and moral subjects. And what I say then, how that ties into is then that the whole post-humanist project of decentering the subject from that subject of free will to with a look towards the structure and the power that structure has needs to be complemented by a decentering of the structure. So, which is then focusing on the limits of structure, which doesn't mean that there's no limits. We still acknowledge that there are discourses as forms of structure that provide the possibilities of action. For example, giving meaning, that we can give meaning. And this is then not a return to the free subject, as is embraced in Enlightenment, that we can do whatever we want and achieve whatever change we want to be. Instead, what we're trying to do is then to acknowledge the negativity of the subject to the extent that there is no subject of essence and there's no structure that is fully able to reduce the subject to subject position. And the subject is empty. It's like in the Heideggerian sense, it's thrown into the world and has to give meaning and identity to itself, which is then, I think, a political moral subject also. So at the same time as we are thrown in the world and have to give meaning to ourselves through discourses, through the structure, in order not that structure to fully determine ourselves, we have to introduce a limit which prevents us from fully becoming a subject position in the structure. And here then my critique is then on the other critiques that are presented itself. Otherwise, then we erase the possibility of agency as structure would fully determine me as a subject and reduce me to a subject position. And that would also render the whole act of giving meaning meaningless. Let's say that if structure would fully be able to determine the meaning that become possible, then there are only two options left. Then we either can say make a meaningful statement or we can make a non-meaningful statement. And if for example, look at Foucault's problem when he writes a history of madness. So what he does, and if he would follow his full logic, then his whole book could not be meaningless because he tries to write madness. the non the senseless, but he tries to give meaning to it. What I'm trying then to address is the, and that whole critique to of Foucault as bien fort by Derrida is then that there has to be some kind of madness in every form of act of meaning making, which requires us to actually make meaning, and that to some extent then limits also the possibility of establishing meaning fully. Very abstract, but I'm trying soon to get a little bit more into the nitty-gritty. Then, to some extent, there needs to be a limit in the structure, or there has to be a form of madness in the structure, which an alterity in the structure, which also requires us as subjects to emerge and to give meaning to the structure. Because otherwise, the only option is that any alternative, for example, if we would say neoliberalism would be the only mode of reasoning that becomes possible in this kind of stage, and any kind of resistance, environmental education would only become a form of irrational or meaningless act, because then, as we would say, structure would be able to determine what becomes meaningful. And what we then also, another problem is then the sublation of difference in the context of portraying the concrete universality. To come back then to that problem, Marxist reasoning, as Trotsky, then he has to explain the Russian Revolution in the sense of the universal historical moment. He cannot say that the historical case of Russia is particular, as he has to subjugate it to the globalist capitalist development. So if we follow that line critique, first of all, we do not have agency, but then what we automatically have to do, any kinds of resistance cannot be explained in its particularity, but we have to underline it under, or we have to subjugate it to a universal form of development and critique and the universal enemy. And what I try to do then in my work, and as an option for another form of critique, is then to introduce antagonism. I do that through Laclau as something that which prevents any discursive formation from closure, from becoming fully transparent and becoming a determinate state. And there also draw on the work of Heidegger and Derrida and Laclau and see as temporality as to be synonymous with not temporality, but of course it is, but with an antagonism as well. And what I mean then, that temporality is something totally different than that notion of history as we have been talking about before, that historical process as universality, but its temporality is exactly which undermines any form of universal history. We are trying to make sense of history, we are trying to spatialize temporality, what I said, but temporality is that which all the time subverts any attempt of making a universal case. And in that sense, a time cannot be specialized. It's always that which tries, if we think of Deleuze and Guattari, they have these two different forms. They have this root, that which tries to bring everything into a stasis, and that which uproots again. Time is that which like forces becoming and breaks up any attempt to reduce becoming to meaning through meaning making. And what that also means is that I think what I'm drawing in my critique is then if we in our critique try to reduce history to, for example, universal history, neoliberalist historical moment, for me, then time is not only that which shows how things are in its universal, but the particularity of conflicts. So it breaks up histories and different historical narratives, and that's what I'm trying to do in my own work, also in empirical work, where I can show then, if, for example, in Southeast Asian context, that the portrayal of the historical moment in Vietnam might be very, very different from the portrayal of the historical moment in Thailand. So what I think what we have to see then is that we in a critique, we do not reduce those historical moments to a bigger, broader historical moment, but we acknowledge that historical diversity in the particularity of the context as a possibility of evading this imperializing Western moment and move that we are trying to reduce the plurality of struggle, for example, in the classical Marxist, that we trying to reduce any kind of feminist, indigenous resistance to a overall socialist struggle. So we decouple these different historical struggles and to allow them their own validity on their mind, on their own. So what I mean then by antagonism, which is that which shows us up, is for example that if we subsume different critical political struggles under one own, under one bigger we. For example, as we environmental educators standing up towards neo-capital liberalism, is that antagonism can show then that we, for example, is not only a we, but there can be political conflicts of interest between those under those we. For example, people in Vietnam having a particular struggle in their particular historical context might have totally different conceptions of that struggle as we here in Sweden, which are also subsumed under the same political struggle. So what that political moment of antagonism then does is to show that we is already split. And what the consequences of that acknowledgement of that we are is that, for example, if we have critical environmental educators, there's a plurality of that we. We often try to do a we as those on the left or whatever, trying to brand it, but we have to think that this we might be a strategic we. We use that in order to show solidarity and affiliances, but we also have to be very careful about that. We not reduce the plurality of that we to a diversity of struggles that we are facing. For example, that there might then be conflicts in our...
Sorry to interrupt. I have to step out because ironically, I have a meeting with Alexander Leif from UNESCO. So.
Okay.
Here's Stefan's thesis for those that might be interested in. So thank you so much, and I'll watch the end on video.
Okay, perfect. You come with critical questions later. my argument then is that if we take that critical position, that we also have then to acknowledge possible conflicts of interest among the critical perspectives, and that which we are also critical against is relative to these particular historical and spatial constellations. For example, that a critique should be a critique in Sweden is a different form of critique, for example, than in Vietnam, that we not reduce it to a particular universal something that we're critical against. Because what I think the danger is, if we do, is that as we have to find the common denominator of all our critiques, is that our critique in itself becomes numb in that sense. It's not able to articulate very specifically what we are critical against, because we have first of all then to find, okay, what do we all share? What I then say is that that's also the strength of acknowledging the polarity of that we is then that we, okay, this is what we particular practices we are critical against in this particular context, which allows us then much more to be nuanced what we are critical against. And as a result, then, if we articulate an enemy, that enemy is not a singular, and that the problems we are facing are not a singular problem, but then they're the acknowledgement that both the enemy and the problems are discursively constructed, and that there are cultural and historical differences that we, in the end up with, that there are different enemies and different problems. But as I say then, that we should, to some extent, be worried about just going fully into that multitude in the diversity sense, that we should not just diversify in a plurality of we, but that we should also then look at trying to create what I call then strategic alliances among a diverse we, that we make translocal connections to other we's, without then subsuming that diversity to one we. We acknowledge the diversity of the we without trying to subjugate it. Because what I think that once we, what we do is if we take a particular we as a starting point, then we're doing a form of violence on other we's. So we're subsuming our potential particularity of a V and I'm pressing it on someone else. So for example, if I do a critical articulation out of the Swedish context, I have to acknowledge that it's not the same V that I'm speaking to as if I take a critical environmental educators in Vietnam, for example. And what I'm then saying is that there's a tendency to an ethics of justice in critical environmental education discourse, and I'm problematizing that notion of ethics of justice, because I think that, for example, in the Swedish discourse, there we have this, in the Swedish context, we have this pluralistic approach to EE, and to some extent, I think that, which is linked to that justice approach, that we're doing a plurality, acknowledge plurality, but at the same time, we are not, because we always, to some extent, including something that could have been included, that we're not yet aware of. But we also, in order to make, for example, anything meaningful, we have to exclude, and that there's an act of violence. For example, in the Swedish context, that we acknowledge a radical democratic approach to education. That is only on the promise that we have to exclude those that are not acknowledging a democratic approach. For example, those that are very anti-democratic and want do not stand for the principles of an acknowledgement of the other, we cannot include those because they're very much those that undermine the inclusivity and the plurality. I think I've been talking very much already. Maybe I stop speaking here and opening up for the discussion, or and then I can come back to it if I want to make some points later. Yeah, very good.
Thank you for offering your math and your research to us. So we'll take questions now. Jada, if you're still there, you can, when you ask a question, put your mic back on. I can start off with a question, I guess. Wonderful work. I was wondering, in terms of you draw on like Lau's work on antagonism, and I also think that's an interesting moment, the moment of struggle between competing subject groups in relation to sustainable development. I was wondering if you're also drawing at all on Chantal Mouffe's later work on the agonistic public sphere as a kind of ideal for radical democratic formations. The idea of bridging, and in some sense, I feel like her work is also a response to those kinds of iron grid understandings of modernity and the kind of consensual critique of policy and all of that. Do you draw at all on that, on Mouffe as well as Laclau, or is this kind of all Laclau?
It's interesting. I have a colleague of mine, and we started our PhD simultaneously, and I went the Laclau way, and he went the MOOF way. So we're having always these interesting discussions, and to some extent, I think, for me at least, I think they in their later work, they go different ways.
Yeah.
For me, I think it's either antagonism or agonism. You can have a focus on what you're interested in. Agonism, to some extent, is much more prescriptive of a certain form of formalized politics. While I think if you follow the antagonism line, it's a constant reminder of that any form of these politics are undermined. I use that antagonism as something that it's troubling. You know what I mean? That to some extent, agonism tries to formalize that which troubles, for example, diversity and that whole paradox that move between social inclusion and liberty. While what I try to go to antagonism as something that problematizes my own moral and political thinking, I think.
Great answer. Thanks.
Questions from the audience?
I have a question, actually, and it pertains to the slide we're actually on now, and the consequences for conceptions of political action. I'm very curious about how... So if what are the consequences for how we conceive of political action? I'm wondering if you can actually talk through that a little bit and perhaps talk about it in relation to ESD policy. How you see that kind of that antagonism or the resisting of foreclosure, the plurality, how that might relate specifically to ESD policy.
I think I start with I think as I said that there's a certain notion of change embedded in this notion of structural power and critique which is what I can call teleological, that they are like this universal changes from before and after, so it's in. And what I think then is the consequences of the introduction of the antagonism as a form of critique is then that that we as I write here the that we cannot know what effects are. It's a very it's a very undermining way of any form of teleological, so cause and effect. I think we cannot escape that mode of reasoning, but we have to acknowledge that it's not as it is. It's an afterhand construction. So I do this, and then we have something, and I said, oh, okay, it seems that this caused this. But the effect is always an afterhand construction, and there can still something happen afterwards which changes totally what the effect was. And my colleagues here at Swedist, they work with similar ideas of that. If you have complex issues, that it makes it very, very difficult, for example, in policy to plan for it. I mean, because you do not know if that intervention is going to have these effects. And it has to be introduced in form of constant adaptation of policy-making processes to change as they all unfold. And they speak a lot of wicked planning, for example, that if there's a wicked problem, you cannot really define what it is, that you constantly have to mutate your approaches to change as it unfolds. And I think that's also something for critical approaches or policy making, that we have to some extent change notions of policy making that are embedded, that that we cannot, okay, we decide this is now, we know what needs to be done, we are going to implement this, then we're going to have these effects. I think that's something that the more radical critical approach should alter, and that we should go in, okay, how can we change this theological mode of cause and effect, or the conception of it in policy making?
Mm-hmm. Thanks, Stefan. Take next question.
Please go ahead. Stefan, by the way, I had a wonderful opportunity to be at your campus back in 2007. It wasn't related to the topic here. It was related to just getting an international consensus on the idea of scientific literacy. But I want to come back to the recognition that the structure that you are working under, and give some examples of political structure. I like to take the specific case of UNESCO, because I find UNESCO is one of the biggest barriers to advancing the ideas that I've read about. And I would identify that it's anthropocentric in the way it formulates its notion of sustainable development. It's also reductionistic because the environment, society, the economy are all individually recognized, defined, even though we have that overlap of circles, but we still have those entities. I happened to be brought into a meeting with UNESCO, the Canadian UNESCO people and people in this province who were looking at education for sustainable development. And it struck me that I was up against the same barriers, anthropocentrism, reductionism. And so recognizing that, I introduced the paradoxical reasoning. Now, Hegemony introduced the notion of paradox. The paradoxical reasoning, and I'll give you an example from the Maori culture in Aotearoa, New Zealand, where they do not have a word for teacher, nor do they have a word for learner. If you do a back translation on teacher, that's a person who teaches and learns. And the learner is, the back translation, is a person who learns and teaches. And so that's an example, just the meaning of those words and the lack of the English. We don't have a word for that. We have to use a phrase. That's the kind of paradoxical thinking that indigenous nations carry out. And it's another example is the sort of the yin and yang flow one into the other. And it's always in flux. Whereas UNESCO, the reductionism, you don't get that flux. So I was really heartened by the fact that you recognized the role of paradox, and I was just wanting to suggest that there is a whole field of paradoxical reasoning which is very much associated with indigenous nations. And we know that indigenous worldview, there isn't the dichotomy between the environment and society or the environment and economy. It's all holistic. Within a holistic framework, you can engage in paradoxical reasoning. And that was my reaction to the very stimulating presentation you gave. And I appreciate that very much.
You reminded me of a very interesting point as part of my PhD, I was interested in at looking at the transition from the global to the national level, and how to conceive of, for example, UNESCO policy documents. And I studied also the UNDSD decade framework. And I think you can actually find paradoxical thinking even in the UNESCO policy document, because on one hand side they say I take it up in one of my papers that they have that sustainable development cannot be the same for every country, as it is, has to be contextualized in its different settings and diversity of the ways it unsustainable development also emerges. Having that said, the acknowledgement of diversity, it cannot be one. It says states in the same document that sustainable development has to address the root problems. and I think to some extent you find exactly what I call aporia, like that impossibility at every center of a statement that is very metaphysical, which then on one hand side, okay, if we all know the root problems, why do we have to articulate sustainable development, all its diversity? Which is, I think, but I like that, what you're taking up. So I think to some extent you find paradoxical thinking, even not maybe the aware of it also at UNESCO.
Thanks, Stefan. Jalen, I mean, it's interesting to think about sustainable development as itself kind of an ethical paradox that we all kind of inhabit differently. There's that argument that the kind of at its core a paradox, an ethical paradox that we all kind of learn to inhabit and struggle within. I'm wondering, in terms of sort of your work going forward, do you see yourself, how do you see yourself kind of engaging with the struggle of the study of the antagonisms that unfold in sustainable development sort of policy context? How do you see yourself kind of going forward with this paradigm and with this research?
It's interesting. That article is addressing a lot of scholars that would be called the critical EE scholars. And they, some of them have going to respond to that paper, and take a stance on my position. And to some extent then, for example, Bob Yikling, he said that I'm positively inclined to ESD. So in that sense, that there are like two positions. On the one hand side, I can be positive or negatively inclined to ESD, and it shows which side I'm on. With my choice now, working with gap implementation, probably I have fully embraced the dark side of the force and build my own little Death Star here in Sweden. But what I would like to make is that I'm totally neutral to ESD. As I said earlier there, I mean, there are different conceptions of ESD. So ESD only becomes something once it's articulated in a particular discourse in a particular context. And I say, ESD in general, I'm extremely neutral, same as EE. there are certain conceptions that I can identify with, and certain I do definitely not identify with. Which comes a little bit in on, I think, on your question, where I personally position myself towards the role of antagonism, which I think is the role of antagonism, what it does to not only on a theoretic level, but also as a moral political being, is that it has to, it asks of us to make decisions not based on abstract ethical systems, but on the particular moments that we engage with and what we see is required and what is to be rejected. Did I get into your problem or in your question, or were you more asking where I want to push the conception of antagonism?
I was wondering where it was. Just in response, I'm wondering another aspect of your presentation, and we'll wrap up soon, but I thought I'd follow up on this, was dealing with the emptying out of the signifier of sustainable development or sustainability. And you made a gesture to some of the work that's been done around that. Some of which draws on that chapter in Hegemony and Socialist Struggle on the empty signifier. And I find it I find it fascinating thinking about sustainable development and sustainability still from the perspective of the notion of the empty signifier that's developed in that work. Partly because these signifiers, a lot of the signifiers that, they talk about there are kind of in the context of, socialist politics, right? But currently in the context of, sustainable development, it's almost like, the term partly arises in the context of antagonistic political struggles, right? As this kind of negative representation. Do you think that critique of the concept of sustainability sort of still has a kind of as a framework for thinking about some of the other kinds of potentially sort of empty signifiers that emerge in these kinds of policy discourses? Do you see kind of utility for that strand of critiques on kind of going forward with environmental education research?
I think I would like to give it two track answer. It depends on if it has a continuation politically, definitely. That kind of critique, I think, because what it does, the whole question of EE versus ESD is just it's a positioning in that sense. But I think if and that's the whole point is of this presentation and conceptions of critique is then that where does it lead us theoretically first, but then also the consequences of theory for our political action. Where I think that, of course, you can critique empty signifiers, and I say ESD is an empty signifier for its lack of meaning. But at the same time, I think it's if politically, strategically, you have to engage with those. As I said, like creations of different ways is a. If we really go into we do not speak to those over there. They are different contexts. They want to imperialize on us. We just stay here. We speak to each other. I think that and then you very much limit your possibility of influencing change in that sense, as I present it. So what I say is that to some extent we need empty signifiers from every critical point of stance. For example, critical environmental educators, a V. In that sense, it's empty as it will be filled of meaning of what we are critical against in very diverse ways. But we need it in order to create alliances, I think, to some extent, which shouldn't then we can, of course, engage in, okay, but what does that critical environmental education actually stand for? And then we might run into conflicts and it doesn't mean anything. How does it fit in here and there? But my point is then, I think that there's a strategical need in order to engage with concepts. We can call it whatever, but if others have already engaged with ESD and that whole critique against it being like a composite or oxymoron, that there's always already sustainable development in there, so that developmental aspect will always imperialize to some extent. Maybe you could think the other way around. If people wanted only to speak development, yeah, they're already doing it. But what is the danger of people actually speaking about sustainability? So can we not engage with what it means sustainability in order to pervert, to undermine certain developmental thinking?
Mm-hmm. All right, that's fair. Your response. I like your emphasis on keeping the antagonisms open. In relation to all those empty signifiers. So that's appreciated and really fun map of your research. I really enjoyed how you put that all together. So Adam's back here. Thanks so much, Stefan. I think we're gonna kind of wrap up now, a little bit over time, so.
I will get home, have some food. But thanks a lot for having. I hope there will be another time for a continuing discussion to learn also more about your work.
Yeah, let's stay in touch. Yeah, for sure.
Have a nice day.
Okay, have a good one.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Bye.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Bye.
Oh,
Jenna.
In the end.